And he's on the line with us right now. Ryan, the focus was on New York yesterday. And what are your thoughts on a couple of key points? Basically saying, hey, we'll wipe North Korea off the face of the earth if you mess with us. And old Rocket Man is on a suicide mission. Not typical when speaking to world leaders at the United Nations.
Yeah, I think that's true, Bill. This isn't what we're accustomed to in a speech to the United Nations General Assembly. But I do have to think this is an area where President Trump excels. And what I mean by that is, if you, the President Trump that you voted for in November was the president that was on display at the United Nations. This, he was speaking to a group of people that is frustrated by the role the United States plays in the rest of the world, concerned that we're not asserting our authority and our power as a global superpower enough. And I don't think I was surprised at all to see many traditional Republicans lauding that speech yesterday, including Mitt Romney, who's been very critical of Donald Trump. So it certainly wasn't the olive branch that maybe you've seen other presidents extend to the United Nations General Assembly, but there's a lot of Americans that feel that, you know, we haven't been tough enough with that group of people, and that's what Donald Trump did yesterday.
So Netanyahu looked extremely pleased with the speech. I mean, he was aggressively clapping at the end.
Well, especially, I mean, if you look at it on the, from a specific policy perspective, the fact that the president basically laid the groundwork for the United States to pull out of the Iran nuclear deal. There's no one that is more, has more of a vested stake in that than Netanyahu. And Israel's long been opposed to the Obama administration's decision to enter into that agreement. So the idea that the president is basically, you know, setting the stage for that to happen is something that Israel's got to be thrilled about.
Yeah.
And there's no doubt that Netanyahu and Trump share a very similar worldview. So it makes sense that he would be applauding heavily.
Okay, so what about, though, the talking about, I mean, this is a strategy, because it looks like North Korea has nuclear weapons right now, it seems, and to get, I don't think there's any clear path through negotiation or through sanctions or any of this to stop it. So is this kind of like the crazy man at the head of the United States that'll do anything at any point? And it better be nervous, North Korea, because this guy will do anything. Is that where we're going?
Yeah, I mean, that might be part of the strategy. I mean, I still think, though, that at the end of the day, that the more you saber-rattle, you know, that it's got to be followed up by something. I mean, I think that, you know, when you look back at George H.W. Bush in the run-up to the Iraq War, first Iraq War, when, you know, he warned Saddam Hussein that if he entered Kuwait, that he was going to attack. And if he didn't leave Kuwait, then he was going to attack. Then what did he do after that? He attacked.
Right.
And Saddam Hussein paid the price for that. And then his son did the same thing after 9/11, warning Hussein that he had to come clean on whether or not he had weapons of mass destruction and agreed to the UN sanctions. When he didn't do that, we attacked.
Mm-hmm.
So now we're in a situation where, you know, now maybe the stakes are a little bit higher because you have nuclear weapons involved, and you have somebody that's even more unpredictable than Saddam Hussein. But I would argue that Donald Trump is being just as forceful in his threatening of using military force, but you can't really find too many military experts that believe that the best course of action to resolution in this situation is attacking North Korea. It would lead to millions and millions of deaths in a very unstable region.
Yeah.
That involves China and Russia. So, you know, you're right, Bill. I don't know what the end game here is. And you're dealing with a dictator like Kim Jong-un who doesn't appear. I mean, I think the biggest problem that world leaders have when it comes to Kim Jong-un is nobody really knows what his ultimate goal is. What does he want?
Mm-hmm.
Does he want to be a supreme world leader? Well, that's obviously not going to happen. Does he want just, you know, more assistance and aid to help his people? That doesn't really seem likely. So, you know, when you're dealing with somebody who you don't know what their motivation is, it makes it very difficult to try and come up with a solution.
And do you think there's talk right now, there has to be, about how do we handle a nuclearized North Korea? What do we do? How do we handle this? I mean, if we're not talking about that, we should be at this point, because I think we're
there. And you mean it like strategically, right?
Yeah,
so like if they fire a missile, like how do we handle that?
Yeah.
And I absolutely think that's something that's on the table. And, you know, the United States has long been working on a missile defense program, which has been limitedly successful, to put it mildly.
You
know, I think there has to be some sort of a game plan in place of all these different scenarios. Like, if he does fire a missile with a nuclear warhead on it, and where it lands, if it lands in Tokyo, does that mean we attack?
Right,
if it lands in Seoul, does that mean we attack? If it lands in mainland China, do we attack? And then, and you know, how do we build a coalition of people to intervene? All those scenarios are horrific, and the players involved in this are also scary, because you have no idea what a Vladimir Putin would do in a situation like that to take advantage of it.
Right.
So, Vladimir Putin has no interest in a stabilized world. He thrives in the chaos, and so this might be something that would play to his benefit.
And you know, the other thing is, too, first off, I have always been under the belief that we have intelligence and capabilities that no other nation in the world has, and I think that is probably true. But I also believe that our, you know, CIA is able to go in and destroy their program, but we're not doing that. We're not going in covert action and taking out their potential for nukes. So that's got to be telling you that we don't have the ability to do that. Otherwise, we would, right? There'd be an explosion, and we'd be like, I don't know how that happened.
Or it means that we don't want to run the risk of what that could mean diplomatically in that region.
Yeah.
So, you know, maybe there is the capability of a risky mission that would go in and either take out Kim Jong-un or take out their nuclear capabilities. But then how does China react to that? How does Russia react to that? And whatever the cost benefit analysis is that this administration has felt that it's not worth it. I mean, I think at the end of the day, what these military leaders and the people advising President Trump are banking on is that Kim Jong-un kind of understands that his lot in life isn't going to get any better than it is now.
Right.
And launching a missile is not going to make his life better.
Right.
And this is a guy who has, at his core, is serving his own self-interest. So he likes the idea that he can shoot off a missile and all of his, brainwashed citizens can clap for him. And I think they're hoping, and there's a belief there, that that's the limit of
where he
wants to go with this. Because, I mean, think about it. What scenario by which the Kim Jong-un fires the one intercontinental ballistic missile that they have, where it ends up that he ends up on the positive end of that?
Yeah.
Even though he has a warped mind, I have to imagine that he can see the forest for the trees there and realize that there is not a positive end for him in that scenario.
Quickly, healthcare, Obamacare repeal and replace. Are we going to get anywhere this time?
You know, it's interesting. A week ago, this proposal by Lindsey Graham and Bill Cassidy seemed to be dead on arrival. But then all of a sudden, over the weekend, it sprung back to life. And I think it's almost like deja vu all over again.
Yeah.
We're right back where we were at the end of July, where there's about 48 senators that are willing to sign on to this version of healthcare reform, which is a lot different from the last version. But they're still going to have to pull over two senators who are not convinced yet.
And it's
basically the same four senators: Rand Paul of Kentucky, Susan Collins of Maine, Lisa Murkowski of Alaska, and John McCain of Arizona. Collins and Paul are probably already gone, so the focus right now is Murkowski and McCain. McCain and Graham are best friends, so maybe there's a chance you could pull him over. What we're hearing right now is that they're working on kind of a sweetheart deal for Alaska to try and pull Murkowski over. But if they push this through, it still has to go through the House. They probably can't make too many changes to it. I think, Bill, the big difference between this effort and the last effort is that the president and the White House are actually making a full-court press to get this done. He was tweeting about it this morning. He's promised that he'll sign it. That's not something he did the last time around. So if you're a wayward Republican who is concerned about supporting this, the last time around you didn't know if the president would have your back.
Yeah.
This time around he's indicating that he will. So maybe that
is the difference.
It's what pushes you to finally voting yes.
All right, Ryan Ogles, we appreciate it from CNN. We'll talk again next week. Have a wonderful day.
Thanks, guys. Have a great week.